just finished in '96.
We did.
I was thinking this morning, coming in, it's strange that this book I'd read before, The Stranger, he talks about a guy who's going to. And he kind of experiences that last day with extreme vividness. His worry kind of disappears. I don't quite feel like that. I'm surprised at it. So I'm going to ask a question. There's no easy answer. I'm wondering, do you sometimes find it bizarre to consider that you're alive? Life is going on around us in a seemingly continuous thread from one day to the next, from one moment to the next. You can wake up in the morning and seem to be pretty much the same person that went to bed at night. But you sort of didn't exist for a while, at least consciously. When you're dreaming, a backstory pops up out of nowhere and you just accept it. Just seems bizarre to me. I don't know if I'm alone in this, but it's something that I should want to figure out. Perhaps more excessively, maybe you occasionally awaken like I have in a deep sleep and looked around for a while. Before you even knew who or what you were, before that sense of self. Marcel Proust describes such an occurrence in one of his early writings. He says, a sleeping man holds in a circle around him the sequence of the hours, the order of the years and worlds. He consults them instinctively as he wakes, and reads in a second the point on the earth which he occupies, the time that has elapsed before his waking. But their ranks can be mixed up, broken. It was enough if, in my own bed, my sleep was deep and allowed my mind to relax entirely. Then it would let go of the map of the place where I had fallen asleep. And when I woke in the middle of the night, since I did not know where I was, I did not even understand for the first moment who I was. I had only, in its original simplicity, the sense of existence as a mink quiver in the depths of an animal. I was more destitute than a cave dweller. But then the memory, not yet of the place where I was, but of several of those where I had lived, or where I might have been, would come to me like help from on high to pull me out of the void, in which I could not have got out on my own. I crossed centuries of civilization in 1 second, and the image confusedly glimpsed of oil lamps, then of wing-colored shirts, gradually recomposed my original self's features. I find this a fascinating moment. I'm excited to see someone else experience this. When my story is really falling away, it's just experiencing. So I've noticed for myself, usually the thought that I don't know who I am brings up fear. Oh no. Who am I? But I don't think that's necessary. There's another type of dream, which may be more common, where I arrive someplace and I'm not quite prepared for whatever I'm supposed to do. Take a test or something like that. This dream is also characterized by fear. Fear of being found out or something. Found out. The Buddhist philosopher David Lloyd writes that a sense of lack, the feeling that there is always something missing, something not quite right, like our basic problem. And if we could only, the idea is that if we only get this, or that, everything would be alright. In Paradise Lost, Milton has Adam recounting his story to the angel Raphael. There's little bits of the Shimer curriculum that image that really sticks with me, and this is one of them. What Adam says, it's a strange moment because he's just there. He wasn't, and then he's just there. He says, "As newly waked from sound of sleep, soft and flowery herb I found me laid. Straight toward heaven, my wondering eyes I turned and gazed a while beyond the sky. So raised by quick instinctive motion, I sprung, a thitherward endeavoring, and upright stood on my feet. Around me I saw hill, dale, and shadowy, shady woods, and sunny plains, creatures that lived and moved, and walked or flew. Birds on the branches warbling, all things smiled. With fragrance and joy, my heart overflowed. Myself by them perused, and then by them surveyed, and sometimes went, and sometimes ran, several times, as lively and bigger led. But who I was, or where, and what cause, I knew not. I tried to speak, and forthwith spake." So Adam wakes up without a history, but he doesn't feel afraid. He just then investigates whatever he encounters with curiosity. He doesn't yet have this sense of self, this history. Well, the point for this, with this speech, is that this is where I believe education originates. It's this sense of wonder and curiosity that Adam embodies in Milton's time. The impetus to learn about the world, by which I include myself, starts with being alive, at least with being human. What is this? What am I? Or just a question mark, an unformed question. But the sense of lack comes in, accompanied by our story, the sense of self, and pushes us around, pushing us to get this and run away from that. And although the sense of lack may push people to learn specific skills, it does so from a motivation of fear. And this type of learning wants to gain advantage from every interaction. The unspoken question behind this myopic kind of learning is, how is this going to end my sense of lack of not being good enough? Contrast that type of learning with these words by a 12th century Zen monk. When the mind is free of its desires, there is ample time to listen to the songs of birds. After Adam woke up, he had ample time to listen to the songs of birds. And look what he accomplished. He had the language. I suspect that the monk and Adam would have gotten along well together. The modernist composer John Cage said, "I was with Takuni once in a restaurant, and he said, 'If I put a frame around these breadcrumbs, this is an art.' But John Cage said, 'No, I'm saying it is.' I'm saying that Takuni connects his activity with art. Whereas John Cage says he connects himself as an artist, but he would want art to slip out of us into the world in which we live. I suspect there's this idea of art as money tied. Someone's let them pay the art. It's possible to look at. Is it possible to look at breadcrumbs as art? Adam could have done it, at least the newly awakened Adam could have done it. The mind that can see breadcrumbs as art, or has ample time to listen to songs of birds, is a mind that is open and curious about what it encounters. Rather than habitually following its inclinations to grab at pleasant experiences and push away unpleasant ones, this mind is relaxed and awake enough to wonder about such experiences. It may wonder in the form of a question, or wonder in a wordless way, like when enjoying the sound of the rain all at once. Both of these these types of wonder are kind of the same impression I get from Milton's description of Adam and Eve. Another bookmark for word of mindfulness. W.E. was the soul of black folk. And there's a parable in it, it's got the parable of the two Johns, white John and black John, and also grow up. And the black John goes off and he goes to school. And he really starts to question. It's like, he learns about the Greeks and he starts learning Greek. He's like, speak like this, and not some other way. The feeling that stays with me from this is just the same kind of feeling that I get from Adam. Just a sense of curiosity. I think that Shimer does a good job of encouraging this kind of curiosity. It's an environment where people are free to make mistakes. Everyone has a chance to wake up. Is that an experience like others? We're confronted with the questions Adam faced upon waking up. What is all this? You may have noticed that people don't often line up to give you money if you ask such questions.